Well, good evening, everybody. My name, as you may know by now, is Steve Tinney, and I'm the Deputy Director of the Penn Museum. Many thanks to all of you for coming to tonight's sold-out installment of our annual Greats Lectures. This year, of course, our theme is The Rise of the City, to tie in with the opening of our new Middle East galleries in April 2018. It's getting closer. And we have selected speakers and topics which will give us a sort of 360-degree look at what makes a city, how they grow, where and why. The next lecture in our series will be on January 3rd and will feature our own Dr. Steve Tinney. Thank you. Associate Curator in charge of the Babylonian section, who will be talking about when on high the heavens were yet unnamed, how the great god Marduk built the city of Babylon. Thank you. As usual, after our lecture, there'll be time for questions, which will be moderated by our speaker. There'll be a microphone going around so everyone can hear the questions as well as the answers. And so to our speaker, I promised him it would be a short introduction. Dr. Simon Martin is an associate curator and keeper in the American section at the Penn Museum. He received his PhD from the Institute of Archaeology, University College London, and holds an MA from the Royal College of Art in London. This is a British fest this evening. I approve. He is a specialist on Maya hieroglyphic writing with research that focuses on history, politics, and religion. Since 1994, he has done field work at the site of Calakmul in Mexico and is known for the co-authored books Chronicle of the Maya Kings and Queens from 2000 and Courtly Art of the Ancient Maya from 2004. Simon has also curated exhibitions at the National Gallery of Art in Washington, D.C. and at the Penn Museum, including Maya 2012 here, on which he played a key role. And he is now deeply engaged in an overhaul of the museum's Mesoamerican gallery, due to open, I think, in fall 18, and in stewarding the next phases of publication and other work on our excavations at the great site of Tikal. So please join me now in welcoming Dr. Simon Martin, who will talk to us about the urbanized jungle, ancient Maya garden cities.
Okay, thank you very much, Steve. So a lot of the kind of jungle, the urban spaces that you're going to be listening to in the whole series are a little bit kind of, you know, familiar. They're part of the heritage of the Western world. We can almost see the ground plan of Philadelphia in these ancient cities. And that is with the exception of the kind of things I'm going to be talking about this evening. These are very, very different kinds of cities, and we have to understand them in different ways. So here, of course, is, you know, one of our classical sites, Rome. And we could also have picked Pompeii or, indeed, any of these sort of densely congregated urban spaces, people clustered together. And the important thing here is that services all come from the outside. So this is a political center where you have craft specializations, you have trading activities, and you have something that's in the middle of a kind of hinterland where the things that make the city function are coming in from outside. Okay, let me maybe move this up a bit more. Okay, or maybe I'll just shout a bit more. Okay. Now, if we want to look at Mesoamerican urbanism, the place you can't really avoid is Teotihuacan. So this is the enormous city in the Valley of Mexico, just north of Mexico City. I was there only 2 weeks ago and was newly amazed by the sheer scale of the place. So this, of course, is a lot less famous than places like Tenochtitlan, which is the Aztec capital. And we know very, very little about the people who built and inhabited and ruled from Teotihuacan. But we do know they were capable of absolutely spectacular monuments. This is the Pyramid of the Sun. And we can see here, I think, somewhere, yep. a model which shows the Pyramid of the Sun with the Pyramid of the Moon, the Avenue of the Dead, and enormous numbers of complexes. So these areas out here, these are not fields. These are actually underrepresented compounds. So these are all a dense settlement, like you'd find perhaps in Rome. We know that there's a close relationship between Teotihuacan and the Maya. In fact, we believe with a high degree of confidence that Teotihuacan conquered the Maya area in 378 AD. And as part of that, and interestingly enough, and you've got some very hot news, University of Harvard, Harvard University, are currently excavating that structure and recently published in Arqueología Mexicana is some small fragments of the murals from that building, and they are of Maya material. So these will not be the first Maya objects found at Teotihuacan and speak to this kind of ongoing relationship between the two places. Okay, so what we're going to be looking at in terms of the Maya cities are also nothing like that. I think we all know the Maya area by now, Mexico, Belize, Guatemala, Honduras, and just a little bit of El Salvador. And these are the sort of the famous classic cities, a number of which we've worked at, Apen, Piedras Negras, Quiriguá, Tikal, Caracol, Calakmul, are all places where Penn has worked going back to the 1930s. And we're going to be touching on a few of these, but what I want to do this evening is to kind of give a bigger time range, not just the classic period, which is actually the full extent of it is 300 to 900, we want to go back into the pre-classic and then beyond into the post-classic and in a way compare the earlier cities, the kind of high point of civilization cities, and then cities from the real sort of closing period just before the Spanish arrived. So this first contact with Maya urban spaces came in the 19th century. This is very, very late in order to discover a lost civilization. It had really been buried away in the jungle with very, very little news reaching the outside world until the first few decades of the 19th century. Then you have explorers who are penetrating into the forest. They're following up on rumors of places that they should visit. And in this case, before photography, they're doing lithographs and drawings and taking molds and generally coming back to the Western world and announcing these amazing things left in the forest. And we go up now to the end of the 19th century because this is Tikal as, well, excavated as certainly as trees cut down by Alfred Maudsley. And this is a period when really we don't know very much about Maya society or civilization at all. This is still the very, very beginnings of our understanding. And because of that lack of knowledge, there were lots of hieroglyphs in these Maya cities, but we couldn't read any of them. And we didn't really know anything about the archaeology apart from the big structures. This fed a big misconception, which dominated from the 1920s up until the 1950s and 60s. And this was that Maya cities were empty. And this is reflected in Tatiana Proskurikos's painting. This was done here at the museum in the 1930s. And you've got a few people wandering around because the cities were only inhabited by priests. They were the sort of de facto rulers, but they weren't really rulers because their job was to, you know, make offerings to the gods. And everybody else lived out there in the hinterland in small little separated hamlets where they would gather occasionally. So that was Piedras Negras. This is a vision of Copan. And here's the idea of it's a very occasional gatherings where people from the countryside would come in and there'd be ceremonies and grand offerings and the priests would be doing big displays in fancy costumes. And that held forth all the way through from really the early 30s into the 1950s and 60s. And what changed it was, again, actually work by the University of Pennsylvania. Because first Edwin Shook and then William Coe started excavating at Tikal. At that time, Tikal was thought to be the biggest Maya city and stayed that way for a while and had a much, much renewed, different, and advanced attitude towards archaeology. So they weren't just interested in the big temples. They weren't just interested in digging and finding fancy tombs. They were also interested in crafts, in industry, in transport, in the relationship of the hinterland to the center, and all sorts of the kind of questions that we ask about every site when we dig them today. But at that time, in the 1950s, was quite innovative in the Maya area. And two heroic characters, Bob Carr and his colleague Hazard, produced a map. And we know, for reasons we'll come to a bit later, that this is an incredibly accurate map. They did a fantastic job in charting here the central portion of Tikal. What you have is the monuments all pegged out here, the North Acropolis, Temple 1, which we just saw, Temple 2, the Great Plaza, and these are all these sort of palace buildings and the fancy buildings. But, of course, this wasn't the end of the map. Oops, so this is just a view of what those structures would have looked like in their heyday. Of course, all of these things would have been plastered and then painted with red paint, almost all of them. So it was really quite a spectacular sight. So this is the full map of Tikal going out for kilometers, and I think the whole extent is something like 25 kilometers or something. I can't remember the square footage, but anyway, it's a very large area. And we see central Tikal, and beyond it, we have these settlements. Now, these are very dispersed, but there's far more of them than would have been in the model of Eric Thompson, who was one of the great proponents of this idea of a theocratic Maya, and really began to overturn things. These were not empty cities. There were actually thousands upon thousands of people living there. It's just that their houses have all disappeared. They were all perishable structures, built on low mounds, and they're very hard to see in the jungle. So this is really why it took such a long time to realize that places like Tikal are cities. But you can see, of course, that they're not cities like Teotihuacan. They're certainly not cities like Rome. And the question is to try and understand why they're different and what it is that's going on in those places. So I said we're going to look at a little sort of a range of time, and I want to do both a very early period and very current research. That suddenly went dead. Okay. One of my colleagues, Takeshi Inamata, has been going back to Sebal. Sebal was excavated by Harvard in the 1960s and 70s, but he went back to the site and looked at it afresh. Sebal is quite an attractive place. It has some very late architecture. This would come from the 9th century. And like all Maya buildings, they're built sort of as an onion fashion. So there's a sort of kind of structure down here. This is just a typical case from San Bartolo. And then another building would be built over it. And then another one over that. So this is how Maya structures, Maya pyramids, just grew and grew and grew over time. Very few of them were built as one complete go. So this is a map of central Sebal. And this would have been originally done by the Harvard team. And we thought we had quite a good understanding of Sebal. But Takeshi started to dig into a very large pyramid, which Harvard had only really looked at in the surface, and started digging here on this platform in front of the high pyramid, and digging and digging and digging. Because it turned out that this was not a natural hill that had been modified and increased in size. In fact, it was completely Maya-made construction. And that when they start looking at the ceramics all the way down, they find it comes from a very early period. So this is a phase that we call Shea, and this lasts from about 1000 BC up to sort of the 400 BC. So this is really much earlier than we would have expected such a large structure, because this stood meters and meters high in its original form. At the bottom, and there were several pits that they dug in different places, they found offerings. typical early offerings of these polished green jade celts, the green spoons, what we call spoons, and figurines and sculptures in Olmec style. Now, the Olmec are credited by many people as sort of kicking off Mesoamerican civilization. They were on the Gulf Coast, off to the west of the Maya area. And that's a very contentious topic, because today we tend to think that that's a little bit too simplistic, that the Maya were around and were interacting with the Olmec at a very early period. And in a sense, this style is shared by everybody. But whatever it was, this indicates that a very advanced civilization was there for the time. And that was a big surprise. So the problem we have in studying Maya cities, as I kind of indicated, is they're covered in trees. And that makes them very, very hard to study. This is the kind of thing that we do some of the time. It's a little bit too much swashbuckling for me. But on the whole, it's more like that kind of thing, where total stations, so laser survey equipment has been used to generate some very, very good and more sophisticated maps. It's a lot easier to do it now than it was back in the 50s and 60s. But we're now on the verge of an enormous revolution. And quite a lot of what I'm going to be talking about in the rest of the talk concerns that revolution. Now, it kind of starts out away in Cambodia, because this is Angkor Wat. And this, as I think everybody knows, is the other great lost civilization in the jungle. Actually, Angkor and Khmer civilization, well, the civilization is very old, but the site is actually relatively late, a lot later than places that we've been looking at in the Maya area. What's important at Angkor is that they've done tremendous amounts of work there, and they've done a lot of brand new work. So this is a view from above. This is Angkor Wat, and you can see it's surrounded by this enormous moat, and with just two bridges connecting it to the rest. And essentially, this is sort of like a park, you know, and a bit of a park around here, and with just this stone structure in the middle. Not so. If you take away all the trees, in ways that I'm going to describe in a minute, you can see that there's a massive city underneath this. But what we thought to be effectively parkland is surrounded by all of these very gridded, very regular house mounds, each with individual bathing pools. We know they're bathing pools because an early Chinese visitor went to Angkor back in the 13th century, and his account survives. It's one of the most remarkable pieces of literary sources of the ancient world that we have, because he describes all of these buildings while they were being used, while the whole city was full of people. And he says that these little pool things were actually where people would gather with their families every day. The heat in Cambodia in the summer is very, very intense. Okay, so how was that done? Well, this is a new technology called LIDAR. And there's lots of different ways you can do it, but essentially the principles are all the same. This is an airborne version. And what you're seeing, I think it's coming out here, is a sort of special adaptation. But it's also fitted onto helicopters and, as we'll see, other things as well. And essentially, it's a series of lasers which are on that airborne machine. They fire to the ground at a very high rate, hundreds of thousands of pulses of laser light per second. When you're doing that over forest, the great majority of those laser pulses will simply hit trees and bounce back. But anywhere from 5 to 15% will actually penetrate through. In the same way as if you're in a forest, you look up and you see little bits of sky, that's where the laser beams will have come through and hit the ground. So what it allows you to do is to effectively separate these high tree level hits from these low land level hits. So this is the sort of representation. These are sort of points or where the lasers are hitting the trees up above, and this is the ground below. And you can process that information. You could say, you know what, we don't want any of the high points. We're the only ones we're interested in are the low points. And take it away. And that's how that map of Angkor was achieved. That's how we can now strip away trees and just look at the ground level and see all the hidden features. And as the technology gets better, as the resolution improves, we're able to see smaller and smaller features. So we're now down to centimeters of resolution. Eventually, I imagine it's down to millimeters of resolution. So this is how Angkor Wat was sort of peeled away, showing these garden-like features no one had ever even suspected before. And this is the kind of revelations which have transformed Khmer archaeology, allowing people to have much more accurate reconstructions of what these places used to look like, and really understanding the functioning of ancient cities in this case. And it's not just urban spaces. We're also looking out there at landscape. This is another Khmer site up into the north, which was very poorly understood. And these are these barais. These are these huge aguada or lakes and reservoirs, which would fill during the rainy season and be used for irrigation in the rest of the year. Again, this is all covered in forest. It's only because of LIDAR we're able to see down to the ground level. Okay, so this is the kind of technology we're now bringing into the Maya area. And we'll kick off by looking at some of the developments at El Mirador. Now, El Mirador, contrary to all of those fans of Tikal and Penn when he was digging in the 50s and 60s, turns out to be a much bigger city. This was something that had only been spotted from the air back in the 1930s. But when eventually people got there and started collecting pieces of pottery that were lying on the surface, they were amazed because it's all very early. So this is prior to the classic period. This is prior to the high point of Tikal. In the early time, we call the pre-classic, cities like this were even bigger than they were in the classic period. But it's still a very mysterious place. We don't know very much about El Mirador. Here's an example. This is why it's hard to find. That's the biggest pyramid at El Mirador. And they started building it. Certainly, we don't have really accurate dates yet, but we can imagine probably at the same time that Ceibal was kicking off, same time those big pyramids were being built there, about 1000 BC, probably El Mirador was also being built at the same time. But its heyday, these really huge structures, is a little bit later. This is probably somewhere between 400 BC and 100 AD. This is the great era we call the late preclassic. And El Mirador was enormous. It has two major complexes and two very large pyramids. We're sort of on top of El Tigre, and we're looking out towards Danta. Now, if this is going to work, which I can't promise it will, let's see if we can. Okay. So this is such a large structure that it is taller than the Great Pyramid at Giza. It's actually 26 meters taller than the Great Pyramid. And it gives you some idea of the scale of this. We don't know how many phases there are. We don't know how far back this goes. There's been no deep tunneling into the structure. But it is one of the sort of wonders of the Maya world, and it's one of these things that's making us rethink Maya civilization. We have to think a lot more about what was going on in the pre-classic and in the late pre-classic in particular. Because out of this jungle environment, a sophisticated, accomplished, and very energetic society arose long before the time of all the inscriptions and all the fancy kings that we tend to study, or I tend to study. Okay, let's see if we can get out of this. Okay. So that gives you a little bit the idea. This is, just see underneath this, is a Tikal, and this is the Danta pyramid projected on top of Tikal. So the whole central area where I was showing that core of Tikal, the Danta pyramid just covers it. Another sense of just get a sense of how big this thing is. And there's some archaeology. People, particularly Richard Hansen, have been digging there for many years. And not only has some of the architecture been exposed, but also some of the artwork. These tend to be quite enigmatic. We don't know a lot about pre-classic art. We don't know a lot about the themes that they're talking about. Some of it's really very well preserved, very, very interesting. It's got a flying figure here with a sort of mask on his back, as well as this fancy headdress. This is his face here and his arm, this sort of flying mode. Masks. This is a great typical pre-classic iconic motif, is these large architectural masks on the sides of stairways. Very, very typical of the pre-classic. And sometimes we have actual monuments. We have stela, and this one actually has a text, which you can see down here. So not only is it horribly eroded, I fear that even if it wasn't eroded, we probably couldn't read it. Pre-classic writing is extremely difficult to read. There's some connections. There's clearly some signs which we see in the classic period have their origins in the pre-classic. But so much is different that it's almost like looking at a different system. So when pre-classic civilization collapses, and it does, places like Mirador are abandoned. Later on, they were reoccupied. But the site, as enormous as it was and however large a population it had, was completely abandoned somewhere between 100 and 200 AD. And this is true of all the great pre-classic centers. So something very dramatic happened, and we don't understand it at all. So this is just another view. This is what LiDAR can give us once it's been processed. So the data itself can then be put into three-dimensional graphic programs, CAD programs, ways of analyzing it and reanalyzing it to show landscape. What you can see out here are different features. Some of them actually are canals, but a lot of them are actually causeways. They're big road systems which covered these low-lying areas that would have been very swampy in the rainy season. And you can still see them. They're so massive. But here they are sticking up above the tree line. And with LiDAR, we can trace their paths. The faint one here, the much bigger one here. And really start to understand the sort of radial structure, the ways in which pre-classic centers were connected by roads. Obviously very, very important and interesting in terms of their politics. And features which are completely enigmatic. So this is something that turned up relatively recently. These sort of pen-like structures, almost as if they're sort of kind of cattle herding stations or something like that. But the Maya didn't have those kinds of animals. So was it used for agriculture? We really don't know yet. And this is another one of these challenges we're going to have to find out about. So that's the pre-classic. The pre-classic was Sebal and El Mirador. We had the very early site, and we had Mirador, which is the kind of high point of the pre-classic. And now we're going to sort of delve just a bit into the classic period. And three very closely related and indeed geographically close sites, El Pilar and Baking Pot, which are both very small, and Caracol, which is pretty enormous. So this is a map of El Pilar. And it actually has two parts. This is one part of the center, and this is in Belize. And then over here, there's another part, and that's in Guatemala. So the border runs almost exactly at the edge of this frame here. And it's a good map. It was in use for quite a number of years, and everyone was very happy with it, until LiDAR came along and showed us this thing over here, which had never even been noticed before. What we're seeing, and these are not natural, this is a trench, and this is another one. This is a double wall system on a hill. So up here, you have very little in the way of construction. but with these massive defenses which made it almost impregnable. What we're finding, and I don't have the images to show you, but they are going to be released in the near future and are being talked about in conferences, is that there are a lot of these things. Out there in the forest where there's quite a lot of elevation and hillsides, there are also a lot of these fortresses. And they're all the same in the sense that they don't have much in the way of occupation. So they're not protected cities like you might have in the old world. They're more like redoubts or maybe some place to sort of escape times of trouble. But certainly they made a lot of effort into carving these trenches into bedrock and mountainsides. So they put a lot of energy into this. This is just one view of Baking Pot, quite a small site. It's been quite well studied and quite interesting in terms of ceramics. But here, it's just a question of really showing you the ways in which you have to analyze these contrasts between ancient features and modern features. Sometimes you can look at things and get carried away with the idea that you're seeing something very special and ancient, and actually it turns out to be something that was built in the 1950s and has been abandoned, and that kind of thing. So interpreting the data and ground-truthing it is one of the most important things. So you see features here, but you really need to have people that go out in the forest. And you can do that with a GPS. You can do a handheld GPS, and it'll take you to exactly the feature that you can see on a map like this. Now, I mentioned the helicopters, and I mentioned the planes, and of course, they're very, very expensive. But as the technology gets better, we're now down to drone-sized LiDAR systems. And these at the moment are really only suitable for quite small sites. You know, you can't fly these up and do the vast cityscapes that we've been looking at. But for, you know, a modest site and a plaza group and maybe a central series of temples, it's quite adequate. And again, the quality of these things will just keep getting better and better and better. And this is the kind of data that it turns up. In fact, this has already been processed. I went to a presentation about the technical side of LiDAR, and it's completely mind-numbing. Probably there's people out here who are engineers and would get on with this a lot better than I would, but it's enormously complex, and it takes a lot of work to get any kind of imagery out of it. But this is sort of the starting point. You get these data clouds, and you can begin to see these structures, and there's process and reprocess with different filters and ways of showing different elements. So I mentioned we're going to talk about Karakol. And this is Kana, which is the central massive structure at Karakol. Almost certainly pre-classic originally, but we don't know because there's never been a deep tunnel inside here. There has been some tunneling at the back, and I do think they found some quite early stuff. But everything we're looking at here is classic. So this would have been built on top of an earlier pyramid. There are a number of tombs in each one of these structures. And you can see that there were sort of all sorts of buildings here. These will have been roofed, where administrative or perhaps priestly activities went on. And I'm sorry, that's a little bit bleached out, but it's a representation of the map of Karakol. And here, this is Kana up here. The B ball court, the A ball court, another big plaza here, et cetera, et cetera. So again, with LiDAR, we can transform that. We can add enormously to the amount of detail. And once this kind of information has been processed, this is not the best case. You just about see them here, terracing. In fact, we know that around Karakol is tremendous amount of terracing for fields. So this is really quite important because you can see how close agriculture comes to the really fancy pyramids. They're farming right in the center of town, making the best use of what is a very, very undulating landscape here, where terracing would really be the best way of increasing your land area for agriculture. Okay, so now we're going to move into the terminal classic, stroke early post-classic. And probably some of you came to a talk I gave about Chichen Itza probably about 2 years ago. And here's one of the maps that I showed at the time. This site has not been studied with LiDAR yet. I think when it has, we will also discover an enormous settlement there. But that lies in the future when these things have become cheap enough to do. At the moment, you need enormous grant money. You need in the region of $200,000-$300,000 in order to hire all the people, the equipment to get this kind of data. But that's not going to be the true for all time. It'll get cheaper and cheaper. The reason I'm really talking about Chichen is not because of the LiDAR. It's really to follow up on something I was talking about back then in, I think, 2015. This, of course, is the Castillo. It's a central pyramid at Chichen. It dates to around 1000. So this is late on the side that we've been talking about. And it's interesting because it's really not Maya. This is a period of the Maya lowlands where, again, they're being heavily influenced by central Mexico. And this seems to be a period where central Mexico has area in the same way as Teotihuacan did, and they put up a structure which is much more typical of central Mexican culture than it is Maya culture. But this is a special day because this equinox. And at the equinox, people gather in order to see this jagged diamond shape, and this is the serpent head down here. So the idea is that the building was so specially aligned that on the day of the spring equinox, the light shines and catches and creates the diamond back of the serpent. No. About 3 weeks ago, I went to a presentation in Mexico. Someone had done time-lapse photography of this feature over a whole year. This feature happens every day for 4 months. But all the people who go for the equinox feel that they're seeing something special that's never happened before. All right. So we're now going to go even later. So this is the latest site we're going to be talking about. It's Mayapan. Mayapan is a really interesting place, not least because we have some historical documents. So these are not hieroglyphic writing, but this is colonial records by the Spanish. Now, Mayapan was abandoned when the Spanish arrived, but had only been abandoned for about 70 or 80 years. So within very close to living memory, people were able to talk about Mayapan and what happened there. So this is a view, what it looks like today. This looks a little bit familiar because this looks exactly like the Castillo. In fact, this is very similar to a building at Chichen, and lots of these structures are like miniature copies of Chichen Itza. Its heyday was later. And as I say, it was abandoned, we think, in the region of about 1440 AD is when Mayapan was abandoned. And they tell us, that the sources tell us, that it's because of an internal civil war that broke out between the two biggest families, and victory for one basically destroyed the whole system and it broke apart. One of the reasons that so many people were living at Mayapan is because they were forced to. Mayapan was a place where all the sort of nobility of the whole region were obliged to live, at least for part of the year, as a sort of system of control. So all the tribute was all brought in from the outside. It's a very interesting system. And no doubt one of the reasons it collapsed is because this was a very it was a prison-like environment. Mayapan has this sort of typical late style. This is a the great god Itzamna, one of these censer burners. People tend to diss post-classic art. I think some of it's pretty awful, but some of it's also pretty nice. And this is the map. So this was generated in the 1950s. It's like the dying days of the Carnegie Project of Washington. And the feature you can see here is a wall. This is actually several feet thick, about 3 yards thick. And it has gateways, if you can see any of them. It's a rather strange shape. That's the center. In fact, the photograph I showed you was just this area here. So you can see that all of this is settled, And all of this is crammed into this walled city. So it's a little bit more like the European things. It's a little bit more like a walled European city with everyone crammed inside. But if, as some of my colleagues, particularly Marilyn Masson, have been doing, is they bring LIDAR to Mayapan, it all changes. Because this is actually a natural landscape. These are not individual buildings, but almost all of them have buildings on them. So what we thought was this dense concentration in the middle is actually continues out into the outskirts of Mayapan. And there were even more people living there than we thought. The original estimates were somewhere between 15,000 and 17,000. This is probably 20, 25,000, something like that. So a much bigger place than we thought. And here, this is a close-up, and you can see these are the structures, individual houses, and these are field walls. These are like their own little private fence. So they weren't really living communally. It was a bit like a whole bunch of gardens out in the suburbs. Everyone's protecting there with their little stone wall, and you can see even the sort of pathways between properties. We close in on that, we can see the resolution gets tougher, closer and closer we get. But here's one structure with just a few houses and a gateway up here and a sealed off wall space. Now this is essentially the Maya way of doing things. This is what we find here in the post-classic, in the classic, in the late pre-classic, and in the early pre-classic. These little plaza groups is how Maya society was organized. So if we look here, and this is a map, we've now moved to Calakmul, which is a bigger site than Tikal, not as big as Mirador, but still pretty big. And you can see these little groups of buildings here, all over the place, these little clusters. This is how Maya society was organized in this very dispersed manner. And so this is what it would look like. There would be a house for living and sleeping. There would be perhaps another one because the family's expanded a little bit and the newlyweds need their own hut. There would also be a place probably to store tools and produce. So maybe we've got maize grain that we're drying and keeping for next year. And it's groups a bit like this that were discovered at a place called Seren in El Salvador. So this was a place that is called, with good reason, the Pompeii of the Maya area, because the whole site was buried in a volcanic eruption. They had lots of warning because, in fact, there is no dead bodies there. Everybody got out, but they left everything behind. So what we have is not only their houses, which are full of their implements, their basketry, their pots, and the things that they use are all in place, but because it's a very fine volcanic ash, we even know what they were growing. Because out in the fields, there are casts of margay plants, of cacao trees, of manioc. And an easy mistake to make in this part of the world. Manioc as large roots, root tubers. We can get the casts of those and see exactly what they were growing out in the fields. So this is a real insight into the sort of daily life economy of the ancient Maya. And we know a lot about those kinds of fruits and those nuts and the various useful plants, you know, the palm leaves, which are used for thatch, the things that we use for rope. All of these things can be reconstructed with a high degree of confidence. We know how these people organize their life. And we know how they use the forest. So there are different plants at different levels. There are different fruits and nuts and beneficial plants and herbs and medicines all out there in the forest. But as we can see, that there were so many people living there that there wasn't very much forest that was continuous. There wasn't very much wild forest, except maybe in the mountains and the swampy areas, because all the area which had could be grown with maize or settled was settled. So what we have is a center where we have the Great Pyramids, where we have the kings, the queens, the nobles, the craft specialists, the people who are making the fancy masks and carving jade and creating obsidian blades and painting pots. But outside that is a dispersed, what another one of my colleagues has called an agro-urban space, a place where people living and farming at the same time, right on the doorstep of the big city, within the city. They are the city. And it's a different way of using the landscape than we're used to. And it's one which is particularly suited to living in the rainforest. So far, we haven't seen huge amounts of irrigation works. We know that there was irrigation in certain places, but the new sweeps of LiDAR out into the countryside are not showing the big canals and things that we might have expected to see. And it's probably because they didn't need to. They were able to produce so much food simply outside their door and maybe in a maize field a few hundred feet away that they didn't need that kind of intensive agriculture. I think these are actually some of the best reconstructions I've ever seen, very recently produced in Mexico, what these places would have been like. And you can see that it's green, there's trees, there's bushes, there's plants growing right next to them. So in conclusion, we have our lords, we have our ladies, we have our fine palaces, we have the hieroglyphic inscriptions. But these places do not exist without a hinterland, without a city, or with people living, farming, and producing everything that they need. And with that, I will conclude. Thank you very much for your attention. And as Steve mentioned, I'm very, very happy to take questions.
You said all the buildings were painted red. Is that all the buildings were painted red?
Yes.
Was that aesthetics, or was it cooling? Was there a reason for it? Why red?
Ah, good question. The red is almost all of it was hematite, so it's an iron oxide, which is not local. This has to come from the highlands. In fact, all the paints and fancy minerals are not to be found in the lowlands at all. In the lowlands, you effectively get two materials. You get limestone, tons of it, and you get chert. You get inclusions of flint. So stone tools were something that was, you know, lying around. But if you wanted something fancier, like obsidian, like volcanic glass, or some of these paints and, you know, other kind of products, they have to come from the highlands. So this is why we know there's a lot of trade coming down from the highlands. What was the purpose? I'm sure they had a big symbolic purpose in the sense of regarding these red buildings. They had certain notions about the idea of blood. But a lot of that, to be honest, would be speculation. We just don't know. But when we can excavate these buildings deep underground and we see them in their pristine state, most of them are painted red.
Could you talk a little bit more about water, how they could survive just in what fell from the sky, number one, and two, what do they do about waste? Huh. They didn't have any rivers or anything.
Okay, well, as all good questions. One of the things I didn't really mention, but I should have done, is there's very few surface rivers in the Maya area. You can almost count big rivers on one hand. There are rivers draining out in Belize, and there are a couple that flow through the central Petén, but there are huge areas where there are seasonal streams, but that's about it. So water has to come in the rainy season. And this is where the whole model of explaining as if we know exactly how they did everything starts to break down. Because with the size of the population we think are there, they must have had very sophisticated ways of maintaining their water use. We know that they made big reservoirs. I didn't really talk about them, but there are reservoirs, not on the scale of Angkor, but nonetheless, they could take hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of gallons of water. So that was one of the ways in which they trapped water in the rainy season. Tremendous downpours. Anyone who tries to work there, utterly miserable between June and into January. Pretty much it rains all the time. And then it dries out, and it gets very hot and very dry, and you really won't see any rain at all in the peak of that time. So they must have had good water resources. The other thing they did, they created what were called choltunis. So this was, the limestone's very weak and very porous, and it's not too difficult to carve. So they would effectively just hack down a sort of tunnel deep into the ground, and then open it out into a kind of bell shape. And then that top could be plugged with stone. Now, sometimes these will use, we think, as dry spaces to keep grain and things away from pests and disease and things like that. But some of them almost certainly were actually, because of their position and the way that there's a runoff towards them from architecture, that they were used to fill up as little mini reservoirs. And that makes a lot of sense because you wouldn't get a lot of evaporation, which is the big problem with the big reservoirs. There are always tremendous amounts being lost to the heat.
So, can you talk a little bit about where the Mayans came from and what happened to them?
Ah, okay. Well, the Maya are Amerindian people. They are the same descent line as everyone in the New World. So all the way down to Tierra del Fuego, the whole of South America, the whole of Central America and North America are all people who crossed from Asia back in the day. We're still, in fact, actually it's another thing that Penn's working on. One of my colleagues here, Tad Shaw, is working on the genetics to try and understand those waves of people as they came in. What happened to them? Well, it seems as if that system, the system of agriculture and politics and the way it was woven together, must have had some unstable aspects to it. One of the things that we know is that, and I'm going to impersonate a chart here, population during the early Classic was sort of like this, and then it zooms up. So in the late Classic, between 600 and 800, population explodes. Far, far more people. At 800, that's when the late Classic Maya collapse happened. So whatever was causing that, it was associated with a very large number of people, and probably an ecosystem which is really just on the edge. What happened to them? A lot of them probably stayed where they were, but through infant mortality and just general hunger and over a period of time, they sort of, population faded and faded, but other people must have left and gone somewhere else. Usually there's a question about the Maya today. There are millions of Maya still living in Yucatan and in the Guatemalan Highlands and increasingly coming back into that central area. So the Maya did not disappear. They simply changed their society. Post-classic society, like Mayapan and like these other places, were new ways of looking at government. It seems as if the classic period is the particular time for dynastic kings. We now think the dynastic kingship was invented. We have some pretty specific dates, somewhere around 150, because the dynasties are counting back in time how many kings since a particular date. And that's where they all end up. So, the classic period was a particular thing with dynastic rule. What was going on in the pre-classic, we still don't understand. It's a mystery. And I think I said you were going to do your next.
Can you talk about your research with Mayan hieroglyphics and what you're finding out with hieroglyphics? Anything new coming out from what you've been observing?
Wow. Top 10. I wouldn't say every day, but I would say every week something interesting happens. And it's not only, I mean, it's slightly seasonal in the sense that there's this digging season in the spring. And this year was a kind of poor year. I mean, we only like turned up a couple of monuments. But in past years, there's been huge troves of things have been discovered. So this great masses of new information to interpret. And out of that, we're learning a lot of new things. But it's not just new discoveries. It's because as we get better and better at reading things, things that were published years and years ago are suddenly illuminating. And I have people writing to me. They're young students who have fantastic ideas and poring over these things in the way that students do and contributing and finding new things. So it's hard to pick out individual things. But I think it's very interesting that the classic period is a phenomenon and in a separated from the pre-classic in a way that we didn't quite imagine before. And then someone else there, I think.
Is the language that the Mayans speak today in Guatemala, in the highlands, the same as they spoke in the classic period? Or has it changed? Or do they
it's
use
different.
The same alphabet?
It's different. It's still Mayan. So the language is intrinsically related to the ancient language. But even back in the ancient times, there wasn't one language. So we know from the spellings of the hieroglyphs that there were at least two languages being spelt there, Yucatec and Cholan. And early forms of those languages which exist today. It's probable that the languages in the Guatemala highlands have been there for a very long time. But they didn't use hieroglyphic writing in the highlands. So instead of all these amazingly rich different vocabularies and verbal forms, we don't have them. We know that the dominant language is Cholan, and Yucatec is a kind of lower, you know, it was adapted for Yucatec, but it was invented for Cholan speakers. And the kings all used Cholan language, even if they were in Yucatec areas. So you have to imagine the way in which, you know, the Russian Tsar used to speak French. In fact, the kings of England spoke French, indeed, then later on German. And of course, Latin, you know, so these prestige languages, that's what they had. So, intrinsically, they all reach back. You can trace their phonology and their verb changes, and there are common ancestors. The deepest one we call Proto-Mayan, but this is very much a reconstruction. It's a very highly technical thing for linguists to work on. There was another lady, someone up here.
I have two questions.
Okay.
The first, is there anything inside those pyramidal large buildings, you know, like tombs or whatever?
Yep.
And the second thing is, how were the cities financed?
Okay. Well, a lot of those pyramids are mortuary shrines. And so underneath, in fact, Temple 1 was excavated by Penn in the early 60s. And underneath, they found the name of a big tomb, full of pots and shells and carved bones and jade and the body of a king. We now know his name was Hasao Chang Awil. The famous one, of course, is Pakal, Kinich Hanab Pakal. He's the king of Palenque. Not only was he buried in the Temple of Inscriptions, but a bit like with Egyptian tombs, there was a stairway that goes down there. That was very rare. There's only a few places that had stairways. But there are also pyramids that excavators have been digging into, and they find nothing. They were not used as tombs. So just because there's a big pyramid, one can't assume the inside is a tomb. So the question about finance, well, that's a really pertinent, really interesting one. And maybe it comes back to this question about new topics. One of the things that any subject carries around like a hermit crab. It carries its own history. And ideas become very fixed, and sometimes it takes a long time to break out of those ideas. So back in the day when people said the Maya were ruled by priests, they also said there's no commerce, there's no trade, there's no warfare. And steadily, all of those things have been proven to be wrong. What we now know, and we should have known, is the Maya are actually great traders. I mean, I wouldn't say it's an ethnic trait, but anywhere you go today, the Maya are great traders. And we have begun to find marketplaces. So where I work at Cullup Mall, we have a 2.5-hectare quadrangular space with a temple on the center line, and that temple is covered in mural paintings of people exchanging goods. Probably some of you have seen talks I gave about that. So we know that there were marketplaces, we know that there was long-distance trade, and we're just beginning to kind of get a handle on how it worked.
Back to the language. How is it possible? What is the technique by which the phonetics of a language that is dead were developed, and what is the confidence that the pronunciation that you're using right now is anywhere near of, to the close to the pronunciation that was used then? And then, of course, there's languages today that are somewhat, and how can you just determine that they're similar? And when there no writing exists of those languages, so spend the next half hour talking about that.
I'll probably end up doing another whole talk about these things. But to answer the question quickly and simply, Maya writing presents the same kind of problems as all undeciphered scripts. So you must have an idea about what the target language is. But even when you know what language it is, and because there are Maya people and there are Maya people living now, we can say that it's an ancestral form of Maya with a great deal of confidence. But that doesn't get you to actually crack the writing system. It may not have been possible at all without two pages which were written by a Spanish priest and an informant of his in the 1560s. Now, this is a 600-page book, of which two pages are about glyphs. So it's a very, very small amount. One page gives a description of the writing system, except that it's wrong. And it has an alphabet, which is kind of inconvenient because the Maya didn't have an alphabet. And then it also has a list of days and months, and it gives spellings for each one of those. And in fact, we know now that they are spelling them with phonetic additions to them. So we know what the Maya months are because the calendar, you know, survived into colonial times. But the key thing was recognizing the way in which the alphabet recurs on the monuments and recurs on the very few late books that survive. And with some very, very clever, studious work that went on for a long time, people were able to link images, which were in the books, to certain hieroglyphs, which structurally they had to be, because you had the same phrase and one glyph changes in each scene, but the only thing that changes in each scene is a kind of animal. So you then have a hypothesis, which is that glyph must represent that animal. And then in Lander, a Russian called Yuri Konorosov worked out that there was a miscommunication between the informant, who was called Gaspar Antonio Chi, and Lander, who was a Spanish priest. Lander was asking him for an alphabet because he couldn't really. And in doing that, there was a lot of frustration between the two of them. In fact, some of it comes out. We can now read the frustration between the two of them. And what happens is the Maya scribe tries to represent the sound of Spanish letters. So when you have, you get a spelling of the Spanish word L. And for H, you get Ache. Because Maya writing is it's whole signs for words, but it also has phonetics of syllables. And that's without the syllables, we would not have cracked the writing system. So it has pure vowels, and it has ba, ka, cha, and a bunch of other ones, because Maya languages are more complicated than ours. They have glottalized forms. So there's a difference between ka and ka. So kawil is not the same as kawil. And cook is not the same as cook. And these things survive in my languages. And those words survive in my languages. So we, on one hand, we have images. On the other hand, we have hypothetical glyphs that should refer to those images. And then we have signs that we can recognize in those glyphs because Lander gave us some half information about them. And then we have dictionaries which tell us what those words should be. So those things all interpolated together, and if you throw it on for another like 50 or 100 years, then you end up with a very, very tight system. So I could say, we can say this with absolute confidence. It's like algebra. There really isn't an alternative. That's not to say that we've cracked it all by any means, but we have 157 different syllabic signs. We have 40 or 50 vowel signs. We have about 500 different logographic word signs, and those are read. But there are also ones which can't be read because they're too rare, or there's no phonetic rendition of them, or we don't understand the context that they're in. And I think there's actually quite a chance that there are glyphs we will never be able to read because we just don't have enough information about them. But on the other hand, there can be some extraordinarily rare glyph that if it appears in a particular context where they do some amazing things. They, for example, when they use logograms, they add phonetic elements to them to help you read them. That's a big, big asset. If we didn't have that, we'd be in trouble. Also, they love to take logograms, so like a word like lakam, which means big. They will spell it one time just with lakam, one glyph, but they'll also spell it as la, ka, ma, somewhere else. And when you can relate those two contexts and say they're exactly the same context, then you can say, oh, I bet that sign is lakam. And that isn't a decipherment, that's a hypothesis. You then have to test it again and again and again in different contexts until you feel confident. So we have what's called the core and the periphery. In the core is signs that we can justify 9 ways from Sunday are correct. Then outside that, there's a periphery of ones that we think are right, but they could turn out to be wrong. And then beyond that, there are ones which we just don't understand that we've just got wild guesses at. And some of them, like I say, may never be solved. So I don't know if that's a good enough answer, but it's the best short answer I can come up with. Okay, one more question. I'm told we can have one more. But I think we're tired out. So in which case, I'll just thank you for... No? All right, one more.
I'm curious about the Mayan city that has walls. That's sort of like a European city you mentioned. Yep. What were the threats faced by the Mayans? And can you hypothesize about why some Mayans may live outside those city walls?
Walled cities are unusual. There are a few others, but this is very particularly a late phenomenon. Most classic Maya cities have no defenses whatsoever. That said, one of the big finds at Tikal was that something like 4 or 5 kilometers outside Tikal, there is an earthwork which goes around the whole northern part of the site, which stretches, we now know, of something like 20 kilometers. How that was used is hard to say. In fact, there's good reason to think it was never finished. But most cities were not defended. And I think that's very, very interesting. It says a lot about the political system. Because I think that there was a lot of bellicose, martial symbolism. Everyone was telling you what a great warrior they were. But in fact, I think there were factors which were tamping down warfare. Because what I haven't mentioned is anything to do with the politics. And in the politics, there were great kingdoms who exerted power over many, many small kingdoms. And I think in the classic period, there was actually a reduction in violence because there were powerful kingdoms who were saying, no, 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 you all belong to us. No one fights between themselves. So things changed over time. There's different, you know, features come in. But essentially, the Maya tell you that they have lots and lots of captives and they're really torturing people and tearing them up. And sometimes it's just the image rather than the reality. Okay, with that, thanks very much.